Hello everybody, welcome to Word Shard.
So in today's class, we will be starting with a horse and two goats. Today is day 3 and the story is written by R.K. Narayan. We are doing the chapters sequentially. All ICSE chapters are being done sequentially. And because this chapter is very big and it is also very interesting, we have divided the chapter into 3 or 4 parts. I guess it will be 4 parts in total. And with the chapter, I have found some interesting pictures also that I have added with it, so that the chapter becomes all the more interesting. So let's see the first picture. I have tried to summarize the whole story with this picture. How? See, this boy is very confused. This whole story, A Horse and Two Goats, is about confusion. Okay, is about how an American comes to this place and a Tamil old man, Muni, is trying to communicate with the American, and the American is trying to talk with Muni, and both of them does not have a common language, and therefore a lot of confusion comes about. The American knows only English and the Tamil person, that is Muni, knows only Tamil. So they do not have any common language. So the confusion takes place and they do not know how to communicate. They only can do some gestures, and gestures are misinterpreted. They cannot understand the meaning of the gestures, and it creates the confusion. Let's come to the story. In the last class, we had done up to this, that the other man interrupted him. The other man is the American. The Tamil person, that is Muni, was talking about the statue. Okay, he was saying that when I was very old, then when I was very small, my grandfather had told me about the statue, and when he was old, his grandfather had told him. Okay, like all the way down from his grandfather's and grandfather's and his grandfather's, the story has come down. Okay, he has heard from his ancestors about the statue. So suddenly he could not finish his words. See, you have these dotted lines which shows that Muni did not finish his words, and the other man, the American, interrupted him, stopped him. I don't want to seem to have stopped here for nothing. Now the American wanted to be productive. The American wanted to mean that obviously I have come here and I am not just wasting time. I have to do something productive. So I think I would like to offer you a good price for what? For the statue. So his intention is to buy the statue, he said, indicating the horse. Now I already told you that they cannot understand the language, but as you are pointing, as this American is pointing his finger at the statue, the old man can understand at least this much, that the American is talking about the statue. And the American is no more talking about the dead body. So he feels a little bit safer. Okay. He had concluded without the least doubt that Muni owned this mud horse. So this American has just assumed. He has assumed that this horse must be Muni's. Why? Why did he suddenly think this? Perhaps he guessed by the way he sat on its pedestal, like other souvenir sellers in this country presiding over their wares. Wares means the goods that you own. For example, if I am a shopkeeper, then where should I sit? I sit with my goods, isn't it? Whatever I'm selling, I sit with them. When you go to the market, vegetable market or fish market, where do the sellers sit? They sit with their goods, isn't it? So the American had thought that obviously Muni is sitting with the statue, so Muni must own the horse. Let us see the picture to understand it better. When we go to the market, we see these people, the sellers, sitting with their potatoes and these onions. This shows what? This shows that this man is selling these things. So the American has seen such a market. He knows that sellers sit with their goods. So he has assumed that because Muni is sitting with the statue, it is Muni's statue. So he must offer some money to buy the statue. From whom? From Muni. Okay. Muni followed the man's eyes and pointing fingers, and dimly means he did not understand it clearly, but he felt okay. Now it is fine. The American is no more talking about the dead body. He is talking about the statue. Why did he feel this? Because he saw the American, pointing his finger at the statue. And feeling relieved, he feels, okay, fine, thank you. He is no more talking about the dead body. At least I'm not going to jail today. The theme of the mutilated body had been abandoned. Abandoned means it had been forgotten, it had been left, at least for the time being, and said again enthusiastically. So the old man is satisfied and he again excitedly starts speaking. What does he say? I was this high when my grandfather told me about this horse and the warrior, and my grandfather was this high when he himself, again he could not finish. He's again starting with the same story, that I came to know about the statue when I was very small. From whom? From my grandfather. And this way he also came to know from his grandfather. He again starts the same conversation, communication. Now, the Tamil that Muni spoke was stimulating. Stimulating means it was very, you know, interesting. It was very exciting, the very interesting language it was. Although we cannot, sometimes when we go to the mountains, when we go to Nepal and listen to a Nepali song, maybe you are not able to understand the language, the meaning of the words used. But at least that the you know, the tone, the music in it, the sweet voice, these things appeal to you. These things appear to be very interesting to you. Okay, it sounds nice. So, Tamil is also a very interesting and very sweet language. And the foreigner liked to listen to it, listened with fascination. He was very interested in the language. He was not being able to understand the words, but he found the language very sweet. I wish I had my tape recorder here. If he had his tape recorder, he could have recorded the voice and kept it with him, because the voice was very nice, the language was very nice. He said, assuming the pleasantest expression, your language sounds wonderful. I get a kick out of every word you utter. Whatever you say, I feel it very nice. It has a nice effect to my ears. It's so sweet. He indicated his ears. He was trying to point to his ears to say that, you know, your voice is very stimulating, is very interesting. I like to hear to this language. But you don't have to waste your breath in sales talk. What did the American think? That he thought that the old man, Muni, was giving a sales talk. What is a sales talk? You know, when these sellers sit and when you go and say, give me 1 kg potato. Then the seller tells you that, okay, this is, you know, 50 rupees. And you say, no, I will not give you 50 rupees. I'll give you only 40. Now he says, no, this is that, this is that. This is the reason why the potatoes are so costly. So you'll have to give me the money. You have to give me 50. They say, no, like this. So that is sales talk, which means that you are talking about your product, the benefits or the positive sides of your product, so that you can sell it at a higher price. So he thinks that because the American has said the old man that he wants to buy his statue, the old man is trying to give a sales talk so that he can bid a high price for the statue. He can say that, okay, there is a higher price for this statue which you have to pay. So he says that the American says, you don't have to sales talk it. Okay, you don't have to give the sales talk for your statue, because I already know this is a very beautiful statue and it must have a high price. You don't have to explain its points. You don't have to say that it is a very good article. I already know that it is very nice. I never went to school in those days. Only Brahmin went to schools, but we had to go out and work in the fields. Just imagine. There is no relevance to why this person is, why the old man is talking about his school suddenly. He says that I never went to school, and why didn't he go to school? In those days, only Brahmin went to school, but we had to go out and work in the field. So we were, although we were very small children like these boys, although he was very small, he did not go to school. He went to the field to work from morning till night, from sowing to harvest time. So all the time, you know, farmers, what do they do? First, they plant the seeds. Then these seeds are to be taken care of. Then they have to take care of the small plants till they grow and till they produce the crop. Okay, all that time farmers have to work. So these little children used to go to the field and work day and night so that good crops could be produced. Now what happens? Harvest times mean when you cut your crops, when you, whatever is produced, when you cut those crops and bring it home, that is the harvest time. So when all these crops are collected. Okay, you have produced whatever you were producing and you cut the crops and you bring it home, then your work is over. Then you leave the land for some time. So at that time, when Pongal came, when the harvest time came and all the, you know, the crops were cut, my father allowed me to go out and play. Now the work of the fields was done, so my father allowed me to go out and play and with others at the time. So I used to go out and play with the others. So I don't know the Parangi language. What is Parangi? The Firangi. Okay, that means the English. We don't know English, and you cannot, you speak, even little fellows in your country probably speak the Parangi language, but here only learned men and officers know it. So we do not know this language because we did not get time to go to school. How will we know English? We are not even educated. We had to work in the fields day and night. So after that, when we got a little bit time, we were allowed to play. We never went to school. We never know your language. The foreigner laughed heartily. That means he found it very funny, so he laughed a lot, took out another cigarette and offered it to Muni, who now smoked with ease, deciding to stay on if the fellow was going to be so good as to keep up his cigarette supply. So now Muni feels, okay, it is fine. Let me sit here. Let me not run away because this man is offering me cigarettes one after the other. I haven't smoked for so many days and now this man is giving me cigarettes. Let me just sit here and smoke. The American now stood up on the pedestal in the attitude of a demonstrative lecturer and said, running his finger along some of the carved decorations around the horse's neck, speaking slowly and uttering his words syllable by syllable. What is the American trying to do? The American is trying to give a sales talk himself. What is he doing? Let us see this picture. So this is the statue. Let us assume that this is the statue. The older man is sitting here. The American is also sitting beside him somewhere. Okay. Now the American stood on the pedestal and he was touching the sides of the statue. Okay. The sides of the statue and was talking about the beauty of the statue. Okay. The decorations and the carvings in the statue. This is a marvelous combination of yellow and indigo. So beautiful colors were here, though faded now. Although it is a very old statue, so the colors have faded a little bit, yet it was very beautiful. How do you people of this country achieve these flaming colors? How do you bring these bright colors? Okay, this is so beautiful even after so many years. These colors remain so beautiful. Muni now assured that the subject was still the horse and not the dead body, said. Now Muni is sure. He knows for sure that this man is no more talking about the mutilated dead body. He is talking about the statue. What does he say? Now he also talks about the statue. He says everything he knows about the statue. This is our guardian. It means death to our adversaries. What do you mean by adversaries? It means enemies. At the end of Kali Yuga, you know, there are four yugas. Okay, the last yuga is the Kali Yuga, when there is a huge growth of, you know, negativity, crime. These things increase a lot in the Kali Yuga. It is said, it is believed that in Kali Yuga, crime rate will increase a lot. And then when you will have a lot of bad people in the world, in this world, and all other worlds will be destroyed, then everything will be destroyed. A huge, you know, there will be a flood will come. There will be huge waves, maybe like the tsunami. And then in a very big horse, the Redeemer will come. Who is a Redeemer? Redeemer is the one who is a savior, who saves us. Whom will this Redeemer save? The Redeemer will save the good people. Okay, he will. Now, who is this Redeemer? According to the, you know, the Vedas and the scripts, it is said, it is believed that Lord Vishnu will take the avatar of Kalki. Kalki avatar is a horse. Okay. Horse will come to help the good people, to save the good people from the bad people. The bad people, all the bad people will drown and die in that flood, and the good people would be carried on the back of that horse and will be taken to safety. Okay. Now we have the horse over here. According to this story, we can understand that they believed that this horse is that Kalki. When Kali Yuga will come, this horse will become very big and he will save the good people like Vishnu. Okay, so let's read this. The Redeemer will come in the shape of a horse, Kalki. This horse will come to life and gallop. Gallop is a way of running. When the horses run at a very fast speed, it is galloping. And trample down all bad men. So this horse, the avatar of Vishnu, he will take the shape of a horse and then he will kill and, you know, he will crush under his feet all the bad people, and he will carry the good people on his back and take them to safety. That is the story. When he was brooding on this, when he was thinking, brooding means thinking about this pleasant vision, the foreigner utilized the pause to say, as soon as Muni stopped, the American goes on saying, I assure you that this will have the best home in USA. I will push away the bookcase, you know. I love books and am a member of 5 book clubs. And the choice and bonus volumes mount up to a pile really in our living room as high as this horse itself. So this horse is a very, you know, life-size horse. Okay. Very big. So according to the foreigner, he has a bookcase in his drawing room which is as high as this. Okay. He says that he will remove the bookcase from his room, and then in that place of the bookcase, he has a lot of books, and then he will remove the bookcase altogether and he will put this statue in its place, in the place of the bookcase. But they will have to go, the books will have to go. He is a member of 5 book clubs, but even then he will remove the bookcase because he loves the statue more than the books. And his wife may not like this decision, but I will convince Muni. Continued, now he will convince his wife that you have to allow me to keep the horse in the place of the bookcase. Now this picture talks about that Kaliyug, when Lord Vishnu takes the shape of the horse and saves good people from dying. Okay, next we move to the next page. Description of the end of the world. Our Pandit discoursed, that means discourse means our Pandit used to say at the temple, once how the oceans are going to close over the earth in a huge wave and swallow us. So the Pandit in the temple used to tell Muni and the other people about how the world would be once destroyed, and how will it be destroyed? A huge wave will come, maybe like a tsunami, and this horse will grow bigger than the biggest wave. It will become huge. Okay, and carry on its back only the good people, and kick into the floods the evil ones. Plenty of them about. There are a lot of evil bad ones. So according to the Pandit, all those bad ones will be kicked into the water, and the good ones will be carried on his back. Do you know when it is going to happen? He thinks that the American knows everything. He asks him, do you know when this thing is going to happen? So let's see another picture of that flood. Let us assume that this is the flood. And here is the horse which takes the huge shape. Okay, it will become huge, and then it will take the good people on its back to save them and kick into water all the bad people. So everything will be destroyed except the good ones. Okay, so the foreigner now understood by the tone of the other that a question was being asked, and said, I am not a coffee millionaire, but a modest businessman. So he says that, I am not a millionaire, but a modest businessman. So he thinks that maybe Muni is asking about the money he can give or something like that. He was asking a question. You can understand the tone of a question. So it must be that. So the foreigner says that, see, I am not a millionaire, I am not a very rich person. So my trade is only coffee, my business is with coffee. Amidst all the wilderness of obscure sound, Muni caught the word coffee and said, obscure means unclear, very unclear, he could not understand the English, it was all unclear to him. But amidst all these words, he found the word coffee very known to him. Okay, this was a known word to him. If you want to drink coffee, drive further up in the next town. They have Friday market, and there they open coffee hotels. So I learned from passers-by. So he has heard the word coffee, okay, which is coffee. So there is a shop which sells coffee, which makes coffee and sells it to the passers-by. So he has come to know from the people about the coffee hotels, and he found this similar to that word coffee. Okay, so he says that if you want coffee, you will have to go to the other town where they have coffee hotels. The foreigner said, I repeat, I am not a millionaire. Ours is a modest business. After all, we can't afford to buy more than 60 minutes of TV. So see, I'm a very poor man. Every day, we can watch only 1 or 2 minutes of TV time in a month, which works out to 2 minutes a day. So he says that every month I get only 60 minutes of TV time to watch. That means if you calculate, one day he is capable of watching only 2 minutes of television. Okay, they are so poor according to the American. That's all. Although in the course of time, we will may be able to sponsor an hour show time regularly if our sales graph continues to go up. So if we are not that much, we are not doing much profit, but maybe soon we'll be able to do profit and then we will be able to watch 1 hour show regularly, because now we are not that rich. We can only see 2 minutes television in a day. Next. Then the visitor feeling that he had spent, the American is afraid that the older man is going to charge a lot of money for the horse. So he says all these things. Then the visitor feeling that he had spent too much time already said, tell me, will you accept 100 rupees or not for the horse? So suddenly he now comes directly to the point. He says, will you accept 100 rupees for the horse? I would love to take the whiskered soldier also, but no space for him this year. See, I want only the horse. I don't want the warrior now. There is no place in my house to keep the warrior also. So I'll take only the horse. Is it okay if I give you 100 rupees for the horse? I'll have to cancel my air ticket and take a boat home. Boat means ship. He has to go back to America in a ship because he cannot carry a horse that big in a plane. Ruth can go by air if she likes, but I will go with the horse and keep him in my cabin all the way if necessary. So he says that if Ruth wants to go by, wants to take a flight, then he can go, but he has to go on a ship because that is necessary. And he smiled at the picture of himself voyaging across the seas hugging the horse. So he imagines he going in a ship to his land hugging the horse, taking the horse with him. He added, I will have to pad it with straw so that it doesn't break. What is straw? Often when we take fragile or breakable stuff, we carry it in straw. So he says that he will pad the horse very well with straw so that it does not break. I have my station wagon, as you see. Station wagon is that strange looking car he had that has a lot of back space. You can carry things inside. I can push the seat back and take the horse in it. If you will just lend me a hand with it, if you help me, then I can just, take the horse from here and put it in my station wagon, in my car. Lend a hand, that is help me, and I can lift off the horse from its pedestal. So he has planned that he will separate the horse from the pedestal or from the stand after picking out the cement at the joints. So he will just separate the two and then carry it off in his car. Let us see the picture so that we can understand this part better. See, here is our horse. Here is our horse that is attached to the pedestal. So he says that he will just separate the horse from the pedestal. He will just take it out from this place and then carry the whole thing in his station wagon. Okay, so this was his plan to take the horse away to his homeland, that is to America. We can do anything if we have the basis of understanding. If this was not the procedure used, then the horse may break from any other place and then it would be disfigured, it would not look that nice. So he says that one should have the basis of understanding. Only then the work is done best. So he says, that is my plan. I have decided to take the statue, take the horse from here to my own homeland. So that is the way I will separate it from the pedestal and carry it in my station wagon. He says, please help me out in doing this so that I can do it easily and fast. So that's all for today. And in the next class, we'll do the last part of the chapter. I hope you have liked my video. If you have liked it, please subscribe and share it with your friends.